Now let us begin worship. If you could please join me at the Unison Center in prayer. Thank you, Lee. Please join me at the Unison Center in prayer. Great God of the old and the new, take our lives and make them like new wine. Refresh our spirits, disturb our apathy, strengthen us with your courage. Make us a beloved community, filled with your spirit. May our worship this day be acceptable to you.
Aloha.
Aloha.
The Spirit of the Living God is in our midst. Let us be one in worship. Would you say with me the invitation to worship, please? How very good and pleasant it is when kindred live together in unity.
We have come from the north and the south, east and west, because we have found a home here.
How very good it is when kindred live together in unity.
In a world often cold and hostile, not accepting and judging, we have found welcome here.
How very good it is when kindred live together in unity.
Amen. Let us worship the God who has made us a people.
And now, if you are comfortably able, would you please stand for the singing of the opening hymn, God of the Sparrow, God of the Whale, number 32. like the father who welcomes the prodigal son. You embrace all who come in a humble spirit. Like the woman who finds the lost pearl, you rejoice when we are found. My dear friends, believe the good news that comes from God. Through the love of God, we have been healed of our sins and made whole. We are forgiven. As a forgiven people of God, I would invite you now to share the peace of Christ with those who worship nearby you. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
I think you can be seated. Did that get your blood going? Amen. So where are we? Let me share with you this beautiful reading from the Hebrew Bible, from the book of Psalms. This is a paraphrase. It is Peterson's rendering of this psalm in a version called The Message. I run for dear life to God. I'll never live to regret it. Do what you do so well. Get me out of this mess and up on my feet. Put your ear to the ground and listen. Give me space for salvation. Be a guest room where I can retreat. You said your door was always open. You're my salvation, my vast granite fortress. My God, free me from the grip of wicked, from the clutch of bad and bully. You keep me going when times are tough. My bedrock, God, since my childhood, I've hung on you from the day of my birth, the day you took me from the cradle. I'll never run out of praise. Last night, at that wonderful dinner, those of you who were here, wasn't that a wonderful party? Yeah. Well, during that time, we had a chance to read the open and affirming statement, the 10th anniversary of which we celebrate on this weekend. And I'd like for us this morning to say again that wonderful statement that was conceived in the Spirit, and after much struggle and conversation and discussion and prayer. And I would like for us to say it in a litany. Now, this side, even though you're on my right, you're on the left. And this side is the right. And of course, there's the choir. And I'll be the one. Because we believe all people are beloved children of God, we welcome them into the full life, worship, ministry, fellowship, and leadership of this congregation.
We do this without regard to age, gender, marital status, gender identity.
socioeconomic background or circumstance or political affiliation. We, the First Congregational United Church of Christ, Phoenix, Arizona, declare ourselves to be an open and affirming congregation. Our prayer is that the variety of the gifts of the Holy Spirit given to those present and those God is yet to call into our midst will make us ever more useful servants of God to our brothers and sisters within our church, our many kids or families, our neighborhoods, and our world. Thanks be to God. Before Loey comes to share the gospel lesson with us and her thoughts and reflections, I'd like to take this moment to introduce her to you. Reverend Loey Powell, as I told the group gathered last night, is probably my best friend in the national setting of the United Church of Christ. We met as newbies on the national staff. She had been called to her position as executive director of the Coordinating Center for Women a few months before I had been called to be the director of the Office for Church and Society. So we were kind of feeling our way through that process of being oriented into that place. It's unique culture and negotiating our way through the myriads of things we should do and shouldn't do. And of course, there are many things that we shouldn't do that we did and vice versa. But nevertheless, we remained on staff and became close friends. And after the restructure in 2000, we became colleagues in Justice and Witness Ministries. We were team leaders in two different teams and shared our lives together over many, many years, many, many wearying meetings and in the life of our church. She is also an avid golfer, and as she likes to remind me, she often outdrives me. So I try not to hold that against her, but she keeps reminding me anyway. Loey is a servant of God, a second generation United Church of Christ pastor. Her dad was a pastor in Massachusetts and Chicago and was a beacon for justice in wherever he went. And Loey has continued that tradition in whatever she has done. So, Loey, we welcome you to the pulpit, and we thank you for your presence and look forward to your message.
Thank you, Wally. But what really irritated him is that I had two holes in one, and he had none. And when he finally got his not too long ago, who does he call first? Because nobody was golfing with him to witness it. Me. It is wonderful to be here with you. Receive these words now from the Gospel of Luke, the word that God has for you this day. Then he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. They said, "Is not this Joseph's son?" He said to them, "Doubtless you will quote to me this proverb, 'Doctor, cure yourself.' And you will say, 'Do here also in your hometown the things that we have heard that you did in Capernaum.' And he said, 'Truly I tell you, no prophet is accepted in the prophet's hometown. But the truth is, there were many widows in Israel in the time of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up for 3 years and 6 months, and there was a severe famine over all the land. Yet Elijah was sent to none of them except the widow at Zarephath in Sidon. There were also many lepers in Israel in the time of the prophet Elisha, and none of them was cleansed except Naaman the Syrian. When they heard this, all in the synagogue were filled with rage. They got up, drove him out of town, and led him to the brow of the hill on which their town was built, so that they might hurl him off the cliff. But he passed through the midst of them and went on his way. Will you please pray with me? Good and gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our heart illuminate what you would have us know this day. Amen. First, thank you so much for the invitation to be with you this morning and last night as well. I had a great time. Who could not have a great time when they're sitting across the table from Greg? After laughing. But it was a wonderful event, and congratulations on the 10th anniversary of your commitment to be an open and affirming congregation in the United Church of Christ. And I also bring you greetings from that big national setting where we do strange things like meet forever. From Joffrey Black, our general minister and president, with whom I now work, and from the child of this congregation, Mark Clark. Mark called me yesterday, and he said, "You're going to be in the church I grew up in." I knew it was from Phoenix, but I didn't know which church it was. So I'm very pleased to bring you his greetings and ask that you hold he and Stacy in your prayers and hearts. She's having surgery on her knees tomorrow, so we will hope that that goes well. And it's wonderful to meet Mark's brother Chris and his mother Betty. So, and it's been a delight to get to know him better now that we work more closely. So greetings to you, and thank you also for your generous support of your congregation, your conference, the national setting of the United Church of Christ. It means a tremendous amount to us, and we hope we are being faithful in living out the ministry to which you have called us and in which we are in covenant with you. Well, last November, I was invited to offer a short pitch for the Neighbors in Need offering, one of our all-church offerings that support justice-oriented projects and ministries. At a church in the Cleveland area, the woman who was setting this up said, "I have about 10 minutes to share the story of this offering and to invite the members there to support it." "Great," I said. "I look forward to it." So I arrived at the church on time and found my host and was given the order of worship and met the gentleman who was the liturgist for that morning. "Great," I said, "thanks." I looked at the bulletin to see when I would be doing the Neighbors in Need pitch, and I was shocked to see that the sermon that morning was to be offered by the Reverend Loey Powell. "Great," I said to myself, "Lord help me." I had no sermon that morning. I was ready to do the NIN pitch. I can do that in my sleep. So there I was, sitting in the front row, and glad it was a church since most everybody else was in the back. You're pretty good here, these four in the front row here. And my mind was racing madly as I pretended to sing the opening hymn. And then I noticed what the Christian Testament lesson was for that morning. And I knew I was saved. Grace had happened. I knew I would somehow get through this morning. The text was the very familiar story of the Good Samaritan, one we hear from an early age on in our Sunday school days. Many of us know it oh so well. But I had been graced by having heard an extraordinary preacher offer a new twist on a very old story about helping those in need. The Reverend Yvette Flinder had just preached on this text at an event at the national offices a couple of weeks earlier. Now, Yvette is a powerful and creative minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ, who came into the United Church of Christ from what she calls a Pentamethabapticostal background. She's African-American, Pentecostal, Methodist, and Baptist. She founded the City of Refuge in San Francisco, which is now a UCC congregation whose particular mission is reaching out to those in the African-American community, people of color in San Francisco who are living with HIV/AIDS, who are living way, way on the margins of life, who are LGBT and Q, and who are alienated from faith communities of their childhoods. She kept finding others like herself. African-American, same-gender-loving people and pastors, or those who are affirming of such relationships who could no longer follow the tenets of their theologically conservative churches. So soon, a new affiliation of pastors and churches started coming together and growing, called the Fellowship of Affirming Ministries. Most come from a tradition where bishops are consecrated for leadership, and in that circle, Reverend Flinder is reverently known as Bishop Flinder. Some of the fellowship churches have joined the United Church of Christ, and some are in the process of considering doing so, and some will remain independent, but the affiliation is there and we have a relationship with them. Now, this is not unusual in the UCC, in case you were wondering, especially not in the past 30 or so years. A significant number of new members in our churches have either left the denominations of their childhoods or have never been part of a church before. What does tend to be unusual in the United Church of Christ circles is to be in worship with people who speak in tongues, who feel sanctified, who feel the Holy Ghost inside of their bodies and move freely at the movement of the Spirit. What Reverend Flinder and members affiliated with a fellowship share with us in the United Church of Christ is a deep desire to connect faith with justice, the doing of justice in the world, in this world, and not the next one. Not just salvation for the individual. Which brings me back to the story of the Good Samaritan. Yvette lifted up the ways we look at this story most commonly. The hypocrisy, we note the hypocrisy of the priests who saw the man who had been robbed and stripped of his clothes and left for dead on the side of the road. And they cross to the other side of the road and keep on going. He's not one of us. He's not like us. We don't have to help him. Others also pass by, but one person stops, a Samaritan, a foreigner in that part of the world. And he helps this man, tends to his wounds, and gets him to a place where he could be cared for. Well, we all love this story of compassion. And yes, we're sometimes challenged and made a little uncomfortable by it, because sometimes we are also the ones who turn away from those who are in need. We avert our eyes from the person who is panhandling, who isn't quite dressed well, acting right. Sometimes we do that, yes. But what Yvette then said was this: our calling as Christians is not just to be compassionate, but also to ask the question, why is the road so unsafe to travel on? What needs to happen to make the road safe for everyone, so that no person is ever robbed or raped or killed just for being on that road? So there I was in church that morning, madly making notes in the margins of the bulletin with the little pencil they had to sign the guest book so that I might have a sermon that morning and not just an NIN pitch. Grace. Thank you, Jesus. And that is precisely the question for us this morning. I truly appreciate the inclusive and expansive nature of your open and loving covenant. You seek to be welcoming and affirming of everyone, regardless of ability, orientation, economic status, race, ethnicity, and so on. It's wonderful, and it's commendable because you have laid out for yourselves a ministry for the next century. Sue very eloquently lifted up this challenge in her comments last night at the celebration dinner and set what you have done with your ONA commitment in the longer historical commitment of justice making of the United Church of Christ. But be aware, however, that as you continue on your ONA journey, extending that, these should sound familiar now, that extravagant welcome to all and not just some, as you continue to offer a space for the ongoing outpouring of the Spirit of the Living God to change lives, and in sharing in the beauty of the unfolding, continuing testament of the truth that love is the most powerful force in the world, some folks are going to want to run you out of town too. It can be dangerous work unsettling the status quo, this matter of speaking truth to power. So let's go back to the text from Luke we heard this morning. Just before the interaction Jesus had with the people he grew up with in Nazareth, when they wanted to throw him off the top of the hill, off the cliff, he had gone into the synagogue because it was a Sabbath, and that's what he did on the Sabbath. But on this day in the synagogue, he took the scroll and he opened it up to Isaiah and he read aloud these words, and I'm paraphrasing here. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for God has anointed me to preach good news to the poor, proclaim release to the captives, free the oppressed, and proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. And then he closes the scroll and he says to the congregation, these words are fulfilled today in your hearing. They were all astonished that this young man, Joseph's son, was saying these things. Wow. And then they became perplexed. Well, do some of that stuff you did out there, those miracles and things here in your hometown. And then they got angry with Jesus when he tells them that no prophet is ever welcomed in his or her hometown. Because they too are held to the same call to justice as anyone else. No exceptions, no freebies, no special favors for the homies. They respond to him with banishment, and they try to run him off the cliff. But Jesus, we are told, gave them the slip and went on his way. The road down which many people travel is treacherous and hazardous to people's health and well-being. There are places along the way that can and do offer safe haven. Places like First Congregational Church, UCC, Phoenix, Arizona. We need these kind of places. Places of sanctuary where wounds in the spirit and soul and heart can be tended and healed. Places which let us cry and lament and scream at the harsh realities of the world so that our pain does not consume us, but rather is released into understanding, held in prayer, in silence, in holiness. We need these kind of places so we can gain strength to go out on that road again and take the next steps, prepared to meet the danger, but never knowing how treacherous it will be this time. The high school student who comes out needs these kinds of places. And so does a woman whose husband has abused her. And so does the immigrant who seeks to earn money to send to her family. And so does the accountant whose job was just cut and he can't pay the mortgage this month. And so does a teacher in the school who lost 26 students. Even when our lives are not in crisis or impending turmoil. We need safe havens where laughter and music and community fill us with joy and connection. You gave me water, but you didn't give me a tissue. Thanks, Paul. That's better. We need safe havens along the road. Good Samaritan gathering places, if you will. But we also need to make the road safe for all who travel upon it. The past few years have revealed to us the harsh reality of how fragile our road is. Even in our country, this United States, probably one of the most prosperous in the world, certainly the most powerful, in the last 10 years has seen millions and millions of people lose their homes, their jobs, their health insurance, their lives as our economy spiraled downward. Those who have always been poor got poor. Those who were the working poor, who managed to sustain their families, slipped into poverty, and many who were middle class also dropped there. Levels of violence in some places, like the streets of Chicago, are out of control. I read an article in the paper the other day about a woman in Chicago who just lost the last of her four children to gun violence in that city. There's Sandy Hook, recently here in Phoenix, in Atlanta, and around the corner from me in Cleveland. The road of life, the passage we must all travel from the time we are born until the time we leave this good earth, needs a lot of work. Lots of orange barrels out there marking places of new construction where revitalization is happening. Lots of remapping so fewer people get lost into places of addiction or being overlooked or forgotten. Rerouting pathways so young teens are less likely to get pregnant and children are safe in their own homes, free from abuse. Creating a fair and just pathway to citizenship for immigrants is one road construction process long overdue, and we have so many others. But folks will want to run you out of town. They can be threatened with propositions they feel challenge their privileged status as a male, or as white, or as English speaking, or as employed, or as educated, or the list is irrational and it goes on forever. But imagine a world where there is no need for gated communities. Imagine a world where healthcare is available to everyone and no one is forced to declare bankruptcy because of a devastating illness. Imagine a world where senior citizens don't have to cut their pills in half to stretch them twice as long, or make a choice between buying food and filling a prescription. Imagine a world free of the bitter, entrenched hold of racism, or heterosexism, or sexism. The spirit of the living God indeed is upon us to bring good news to the poor, release the captives, give hope to the hopeless. So Jesus did slip away before the crowd had a chance to toss him over the cliff. How did he do this? You would think that so many folks would have an easy time keeping track of him, that someone could run just as fast as he could or overpower this young man. But we are told that he slipped away from the crowd and went on his way. How did he manage that? My guess is that Jesus understood something about mob mentality. When people get all worked up about something and that mob mentality takes over, the intelligence quota of such groups drops to about zero. Crowds all worked up in a frenzy are, well, stupid. They are all about themselves. Individual judgment and morality go out the window as they come together around the lowest of the lowest common denominators. The crowd could be 2 or 3 or 3,000. But mobs end up engaging in activity that the individuals in that crowd would most likely not do if they were by themselves. One person alone probably wouldn't have come up to Jesus and say, "Hey, dude, let's have a picnic up at the top of the hill." So Jesus, knowing that the crowd was all about itself and no longer about him, simply left them to their madness. And on his way he went. So I would encourage you to do this. Keep on living into your O&A commitments with intention, with courage, with joy, and most importantly, with each other. Expand the circle. It will never, ever be too big. Never. Don't let the naysayers deter you or turn you back. Have those honest discussions that led to your O&A commitments and your covenant in an ongoing way, respecting the differences but remaining held by God's invigorating and grace-filled spirit. We can give the opposition so much power sometimes when all they are dust in the wind. Be realistic, but don't lose sight of where you are headed. Along with those three UCC core values of extravagant welcome, continuing testament, and changing lives, the next time I hear, I know they're just going to roll off your tongue. Remember the motto of our denomination, that they may all be one. This comes from the Gospel of John, and it's inspired by our denomination's desire to join others in the Christian faith and common purpose to make this a better world. This world, not the next one. Being one in community does not mean being identical. Being one in Christ means rejoicing in who each of us are, in our unique and our distinct differences, but understanding that we are joined by a spirit much bigger than we are and held by a love that will never let us go. So good people, get on the road and keep on doing what you need to do to make it safe for all of God's people. All those travelers know that others are already out there with bulldozers and sign makers trying to direct traffic away from danger. And as I experienced at that church a couple of months ago, you don't need to be fully prepared in the way you think you might need to be. Everything you need is already with you. Blessings upon your journey. See you out there. Amen.
Thank you, Loey. Thank you for inspiring us, challenging us, and saying just what we needed to hear. It is by amazing grace that we have been led this far, and it is through the grace of God that we will be led into the future. So, and now go forth into the world, challenged to be on the road, to be instruments of God's peace and reconciling love on the road, sources of healing, to heal the divisions in our midst through the love of God which abides in all of us. And in the knowledge that you do so, may you have peace. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.